Yes, Nidhi, we are live.
Good afternoon, everyone. Very warm welcome to all the audience lecture. Today, our resource person is Dr. Geeta ma'am. She is going to talk on the topic, The Unknown in the Known, the lesser known narratives, facts, and imaginations of Bangalore city. It's a very interesting topic. I warmly welcome you, ma'am, to this e-lecture. Thank you for accepting our invitation. I warmly welcome you, ma'am. And I also welcome co-founder and co-host of the History Enthusiast page, Ms. Manali Momaya. Now I request Manali to introduce our today's speaker.
Thank you so much, Nidhi. I also welcome you to this online lecture, and I also welcome all our viewers, without whose support none of this can be possible. It is a privilege to be introducing Dr. Geeta Badikkilaya ma'am today on our platform. A banker by profession and a passionate heritage activist, Dr. Geeta is the founder trustee of Destination Heritage, which is into creating awareness of India's heritage, focusing on the youth. Besides a master's in botany, she also has a PG diploma in Indology and a PG diploma in journalism and a PhD in Jaina folklore. She taught Hinduism and Indian art and architecture at Christ University for 5 years as a guest faculty. As an independent researcher, she has documented the socio-cultural happenings at 4 Kumbh Melas besides other projects. She was a central advisory board member for child labor, Government of India from 2008 to 2011. She is presently the managing trustee of the Indo-Japanese Lotus and Chrysanthemum Trust. She is a life member of Indian Art History Congress and is the chief editor for one of their commemorative volumes, which is to be published soon. She has conducted Bengaluru heritage walks for 450 college students. She has created, curated recently a week-long history mentoring program for 9th, 10th, and 12th standard students. Storytelling workshops were successfully conducted in colleges. In the last one year, she has curated 61 webinars and conducted which were conducted on a various range of heritage subjects. Her name finds an entry in the Limca Book of Records 2008 for highlighting the bioheritage site of Nallur in the nature section. This was her dissertation that bagged 2 rolling shields at Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan journalism course as the best project for the year 2008. She has presented many research papers at national and international seminars and webinars. Recently, in one national webinar, her paper was declared the best paper. She is invited as judge for many college competitions and to chair webinar sessions. She is well traveled within and abroad to 25 countries. Her life's motto is understanding the unknown from the known. And that same motto, it is also the main theme of today's lecture. So once again, ma'am, it is a great honor to be introducing you on our platform. And we hope that our association continues to flourish. I now request you, ma'am, to begin with the lecture.
Thank you so much, Manali, for the nice introduction. You know what? When an introduction is read out on a platforms like this, it always sounds more interesting than what it was when I was drafting it and going through it. So thank you so much for nicely putting it across. And also thank you, Nidhi, for persisting, because I am more of a heritage walk person. I am very comfortable taking the students and showing them the places around and talking however I want. Whereas very rarely I accept such talks because I'm preoccupied with other things. Anyway, because it is a student body, it is always very interesting to share my thoughts. So I always feel that an understanding of local history will make us understand who we actually are, because we are who we are because of the legacy left behind by our ancestors or the previous 3-4 generations. And in this connection, it is very sad that an intact study in 1984 made a study of all the built structures in Bengaluru, and they found, and the number was then plugged at 834 or 54. But 30 years later, when they did a resurvey, the number was only 354. Now, what has happened to these structures? Why have they not been taken care of? Why this would not have happened if there was a vigilant citizen initiative? There is, to some extent, in Bengaluru. They are doing a wonderful job. They are raising their voices. And to some extent, like, for example, Balabruhi. So it is prevented from becoming a club for the MLAs and our legislative members. So there are so many things which they have done, but still the government officials, policy makers, they should have a heritage policy in place to see that such structures are not demolished or taken away. And if you want to build any new structures, let it be around these old structures, remain a part of that. Because if you see London, it's an open history book. And there are about 2,000 plaques. You simply read those plaques and then you understand the whole history. Whereas in Bengaluru, there is a scope for having 5,000 plaques. So that is the amount of history that we have. And usually when I take the students on heritage walks, they say, what does Bengaluru have to offer? Because they are already always in BTM layout, and then in Koramangala, Indiranagar, IT City. So they think that is the whole of Bengaluru. They don't come to this side, like example, especially the Pete area, not knowing that the city's beginnings is from that. So this talk today will look beyond mere historical data and draws attention to the unknown and the known. So we know that, is there an echo? There is an echo happening, Nidhi?
I'll check, ma'am.
Okay. So... So this talk will draw attention on the unknown in the known, and narratives of imaginations of the times that have crafted today's Bengaluru for a better understanding. In fact, Bengaluru has a very rich intangible and natural heritage, along with the structures, both secular and also non-secular. There is a rich contribution by its poets, writers, singers, dancers, musicians, sportsmen, engineers, scientists, to name a few. All these have made Bengaluru for what it is today. Imaginations always tell us something about the city. It is imagined by groups of people, dominant groups. And as such, we find that the imaginations are diverse. From Bengaluru to Bangalore and back to Bengaluru itself suggests a diversity of imaginations. So I will just highlight some of the turning point events for a better understanding of the local history, because many people think Bengaluru is an IT city, but it is much more than that. So we can start off by saying that there is no consensus about the name of this place. It was also known as Billi Kallu Uru, as told by Dr. Chidananda Murthy, because of the white stones which was available in the Balaipet area, the quartz white which was available in the Balaipet area. It is also known as Bengavalu Uru, that is the Uru of the bodyguards, because that was where the Hoysalas had in this area their bodyguards. Then it is also known as Benga Uru. Benga meaning it is that sort of a flower which was, it's red in color, which was very predominant in that area. It is scientific name is Pterocarpus marsupium. And because of that, probably that could be why this name, it fits in very well for the concept of the name Bengaluru. Then it is also called as Benda Kallu Uru, because at some point of time the granite stones become so hot that it is very difficult to even step on that. Then Dr. Aruni, the ICHR deputy director, calls it as Venkanna Uru, because there was a predominant denomination of the Sri Vaishnavites and many temples had Venkanna in them. So he said it could also be Venkanna. And all this, there is, though there are some three or four scholars who have done their PhD on Bengaluru, there is no consensus. Nobody has said, look, this is what it is, and we don't have such information. Now, can we please have the slide? Can you make the screen bigger?
Yes, ma'am. I will put the...
Yeah.
Yes.
The topic is this talk will concentrate on discovering Bangalore. How do we discover Bangalore? It is the unknown in the known, and also lesser known narratives and facts and also imaginations. So this will be the talk that I will be concentrating upon. This is only the wet. You cannot make bigger than this, Nidhi. This slide cannot be made bigger.
Ma'am, to the viewers, it will be visible completely.
Okay. Thank you. So I would like to now suggest what are the known, which we all know. We all know that Bengaluru was formed in 1537. But what we should realize is he did not come all of a sudden and didirage ee ooru nanu maadibuttene Bengaluru. There is nothing like that. There was earlier in that area a Agrahara. And that Agrahara had its own temples, Garadi Mane or whatever, a full-fledged settlement. That's why in some records that area is also known as Kalyani Nagara, because of the amount of water bodies and lakes that were available in that area. But if you go beyond 1537, Bengaluru, we can say that it has got its history right going to the Iron Age, wherein you also found microliths and megalithic structures all around Bengaluru. Today, they were all villages at one part of time, which have today become a part of Bengaluru. So we should understand that these were all early settlements. And the very fact that Roman coins was found in Jalahalli and Yeshwantpur also states that this was a place where trade was going on since long. So we call Kempe Gowda, who was the founder of this place, as chieftain Palegara. Kempe Gowda Palegara, but he is not a Palegara. It should be remembered that he was anointed as Yuvaraja, because he comes from a line of the Yelahanka Nadu Prabhu. So they were already Rajas in those. They are called as Prabhu. We think that maybe he's a Palegara. No, he's not a Palegara. He was anointed as Yuvaraja. And this is seen in an inscription stone in Biskuru. And there he mentions about the inauguration of the Hebbagalu. And somewhere down he says that he was anointed as the Yuvaraja, because in those times it was only the Maharajas and Yuvarajas who could set up inscription stones. All the other people had no authority to raise inscription stones as and when. It was at that time. Later on many people have erected these inscription stones, but at that point of time. And it was in 1532 that Achyuta Raya gave him the title as Nayakantana. So this clearly shows that he was a Yuvaraja and a Maharaja later on. Then we see, I will show you later on, then we will see the depiction of Kempe Gowda. If you go to the commissioner's office and the BDA offices, public offices, you will find a statue of Kempe Gowda on a horse wearing a North Indian style of jubba and pajamas. But I don't think that was what the dress of the 16th century, because if you go, there is a statue of Kempe Gowda in in Shivagange, in the temple there, and it is entirely different, wherein he is bare-chested and having a kachcha type of thing. But I think this they wanted to depict him like he was a valorous king who was very brave. Maybe it was in that mold that they have put this statue. And then there's also a picture of this in that city institute. and maybe they took that, I don't know at what time, somebody has during the Maratha period or something, somebody would have painted it. So they took that picture and have made it as the picture of Kempe Gowda. But I feel that that depiction itself is not very appropriate. Then we find that we also say there are so many legends. Legends is also okay in some point of view to understand the facts better. So we have many legends that he saw a hare which was, running against a fox, and also Bendakaluru of an old woman. So there are legends. But the one, there's also another legend of Lakshmamma. She was the daughter-in-law of Kempe Gowda. And when he built his fort, he also built some gates. So the one gate, the Anekal gate, was not being properly erected. Whenever he would erect it, it would fall off. So when he asked his purohits, the royal priest, they said that no, it needs a sacrifice of a pregnant woman. Only then will the works move forward. This was her, but he was a very progressive ruler. So he didn't want to do this sacrifice. He was in a dilemma. Then his daughter-in-law, she gives herself up in the larger interest of forming a town. And that sacrifice is commemorated by way of a memorial in her name, which is there in Koramangala. And he also built a temple in her memory. So this legend, I feel, because it is backed by certain fact, maybe it did happen and it is also true. Then we also think that he just came sighting the land and then saw this was a very good area. No, it didn't happen anything like that. He took lots of research. He has done, we think that we do research, but he has done his lots of research, because if you go back to the history of the formation of Londonium in the 78 AD or so, you find that it was also in an oval fort, and it also had gates. So did he understand from those times? Did he make a study to make a similar fort with the gates? Then this was a land, because of his valor, what was happened, there was Ganga Raja, who was the chieftain of Srirangapatna as well as Srivanasamudram. And he was a very powerful and ambitious ruler, and he was giving a threat to the Vijayanagara kings. So to stop that threat, because already they were having threats from Adil Shahi, the sultans and this thing, and also they didn't want the small skirmishes to take away their energy and the concentration. So in such a situation, it was Kempe Gowda like generals who saw to it that he did not become powerful and did not overcome the Vijayanagara kings. And ultimately, he dies somewhere around 1512 or 1515. And after that, because he has proved his valor, it is Achyutaraya who gives this area of today's Pete area as a gift for him. So he surveys that area. And then he finds that it is very strategically located, because he knew that this was a trade place. It is so situated in the peninsula that it is 310 kilometers from the east coast and 310 kilometers from the west coast. It is very strategically positioned. And then he saw that people used to go, traders and business used to happen, and nobody used to pay taxes. So he thought, if I build up my city here, I can collect the taxes and make this a very prosperous city. And when he built, it was always the Pete and the Kote in the 16th century. And he was so shrewd that he invited mercantile community to come and start the business. That's why you have in the Pete so many commodities. Like, for example, in Londonium, you have the Bread Street, Thread Needle Street, Ironmonger Street. So there also the streets were named after the vocations, after the profession. Similarly, here also he has made intersections, because he made a way in such a way it was bisected. The fort was area was bisected into north and south, east and west. So the north and south was from Elahanka to KR Market, and from east to west was from Dharmaraya Temple, OTC Road. And in this, he has divided the area into 28 or 31 places, and each one was given a name. So it was called the Tarugupet, where retail business would take place. Then it was called Arulapet, Cotton, then Cottonpet, which was named later on because of the good work done by Mark Kabbanpet. Then also you have Ganigarapet. Then you have Kumbarapet. Then there are so many, depending, Mutyalapete, then Ragipete, Balepete. So depending upon the business that these merchants were carrying on, the names were given. So the streets were named after the commodities being traded. And each street, they had their own, because it was a community, they had the option of having their own temples, Garudi Mane, and so many other things. Then we see that there are two wars which took place, the third and fourth Anglo-Mysore wars, which was one of the bloodiest wars. And it was in 1791 that Tipu Sultan gave a shock to the Britishers, because they won the war and they had to sign a treaty, and he got back certain lands which was given to them. So he won the war because of using the first metal cased rockets. So at a time where rockets were simply were used for diversion, especially the Chinese rockets, which were used for during celebrations and also for small diversions, this became the full-fledged armament used during war. So it was very powerful. I will explain it later on. And then we see that Pete was a very powerful trading center right from the 16th century as of today also. Many people think it's only the IT sector which is very powerful bringing in the commerce. But no, even to this day, the amount of business that takes place, if you go and see there, all the IT parts are manufactured in that area. Silver Jubilee Park nearby, and it is in Gadis, in Bundis, that they are taken and brought to the main roads. So even to this day, the necessary parts which is required for many of the industries goes from this Pete area. So as of then and as of now, it is still a major commercial center. Then this is called, as people know, it is called by so many monikers. It is called as the Garden City and also the Pension Paradise. The Garden City was not because we had a Lal Bagh or a Kabban Park, but it was because all the houses, they were huge houses. They had large compounds and they had variety of plants, even kitchen gardens, flowering plants. Each house had this. And that's how this city got the place as the Garden City. But why is it not to be seen? That is because in 1976, when land reforms have come, the people could not hold beyond a certain level. So they divided those lands, made it into a smaller block so that they avoid the taxation and also taking away by the government. And then some of them were taken by the real estate. They made buildings. And that's how the concept of having a garden was lost. Then we also find that it is called as Pensioner's Paradise. So this was Pensioner's Paradise is only pertaining to the cantonment area, not in Pete, because business people don't have any pension concept at all. So it was only what was happening in the cantonment area that came to be branded as Bengaluru so-and-so, so-and-so, forgetting that there's another part, the Pete area, which also contributes and where also you find different categories of people. That's why I say this Bengaluru is four cities in one. It is the Pete, which has got a different culture. Then you have the extension areas like the Chamrajpet, Baswanagudi, Malleshwaram, which is another set of people happening there, which is entirely different. Then you have the cantonment, and then you have today the IT city. So I would say all these four different cities are four phases of Bengaluru, but all put together, they come to one main conglomerate known as the city of the IT city of Bengaluru. So Pensioner's Paradise was because the people who were serving with the British, either in the army or in their services, they after they retired, they bought houses, bungalows in that, that cantonment area, because they were living in that and they were so used to the spacious, clean space as compared to the Pete area that they settled there. And most of them were Eurasians or Anglo-Indians. So these were the generation of mix of Indian and the Britishers. So it was they, most of them, who also bought bungalows and lived only in that area. So because of that, it was known as Pensioners Paradise, but it does not, but it has not included the other parts of Bengaluru. Then we talk about globalization, and that IT has brought in globalization, say around 88 to of date. But this concept is not new to the city. There have been waves of globalization, which I will cover later on, and IT is one of the latest. So globalization has never been, if you take right the Roman trade, which was passing through the area of Bengaluru, then that itself, we had a sort of an international trade happening. Now, coming back, I just lost track. So when Kempegowda saw this place, he also thought, because of taxation, he can make a good revenue, then he can bring a mercantile population. And then he also saw this was a crucial area for trade from east coast to west coast. And even from Konkan, they had to go through this, pass through Bengaluru and then go, because you have the Satyamangala forest wherein it's a dead end and you cannot go there. So he thought this, and also from Bengaluru, it is easy to go to through Yelahanka to Hyderabad, Pune, Mumbai, and so forth to the main trading center. So taking all this in mind, he said, this is the best space, place wherein I can form my city. So that is how it has come. Not because he saw some hare chasing some fox that he thought, let me make it. No, he had very intelligently and assuredly thought of as to how he should build his city and how he should make it very prosperous. Then we also have in 1638, when the Marathas, because at that time they became so very prosperous that they were, the Marathas and other people were eyeing this place. So it was under Ranadullah Khan that the Shivaji was sent by the Sultans, and he came here, Shivaji's father, Shaji. In fact, he was accompanied by Ranadullah Khan, and then he was able to get this place. In fact, he lived here for nearly some 8 to 10 years, and he had Shivaji's father, Shaji, he built a palace for himself in Chekpete. There is a Vijayalakshmi theater once upon a time, now it is not there. Somewhere next to that was his palace, and Shivaji grew there. It is said that Shivaji married a Pune girl in Bengaluru itself. Then this is known as a manufacturing center. We forget that before IT, this was a manufacturing center because of a very educated technical people, workforce. And what happened was, this manufacturing, at some point of time, they let the manufacture of small parts to small-scale industries. And at that time, it was at that time that there was an increase of 70% population. And this, and also the amount they generated in that period was 29.78 billion was the turnover. So it is not only IT that has brought in revenue, but manufacturing, and manufacturing let out to small scale industries. And then you had the, of the small scale industry, it was the garment industry that had a defining say in the commerce of the place. And then you find that we say that in 1905, electricity came, and that Bengaluru was the first place in Asia. It was from Shiva Samudram Hydroelectric Works that the line was drawn for KGF, because it was a mine, so they were going deep, 2,000 feet inside the mines, so which was very dark, so they wanted some light, so this they thought, let us draw. And incidentally, Bengaluru was on the way, so the electricity happened in 1905, I think. But before this, 16 years before that, in 1881, in the Pete area, there was the Binni oil mills. The oil mills, they were using candles, and it was quite a drain on their resources and savings. So they used a dynamo for the oil making machines, and that's how that area was lit. So more than 1905, we had a semblance of some sort of an electricity, though not by power or something, but it done in a very innovative way by the Binni oil mills. Then we talk about the Bangalore rockets. which was used by Tipu Sultan in both the wars. And these were called as Bangalore torpedoes. And this Bangalore torpedoes was used in World War I and II by the British, the US Army, which I will explain later. So this is the description of Bengaluru in 1670, which is found in Shiva Bharata, which is an epic poem on Shivaji. It says that, "That matchless city with smart fortifications and towers, the city boasted a great market. It teemed with lakes, each house graced by a well. Fountains gurgled at every square. Trees thick with flowers and shade lined each home garden. And the walls had lovely murals that transfixed passers-by. A strong city gate topped with turrets, a fort wall guarded by a regiment of veteran soldiers, and cannons in unreachable watchtowers atop tall ramparts, girded by bottomless moat, glimmering with water and dotted with countless lakes, each as big as sea, and temple towers gleaming like the golden peaks of Mount Meru. All adorn this city." Just see, if we don't know the description of Bengaluru now, this gives a description. It was in Marathi, so this is a translation which I have sourced from Intact's Discovering Bangalore. So this shows what a beautiful city it was then and even now also. So by this description, we know how this city was in the 16th, 17th century. Then, like I said, early history, we went through it was the Iron Age. We find microliths were found, and megalith structures were found in Banargatta area. Then you had the Gangas ruling from 4th to 11th century. And in the Parvati Nagareshwara temple in Begur, there was an inscription which was found underneath the Garbhagraha. So this was during some renovation work, it was found. And in that, you find the first mention of the name Bengaluru. That means this is not an innovation of Kempe Gowda himself. It is also said that his mother and daughter-in-law, they came from Halle Bengaluru, which today could be Kodige Halli. And it could, some say it is also somewhere near the Pete area. But this Begur inscription says that in 890 AD, there was a village by the name of Bengaluru. I will show you the slide when it comes there. Then we had the Nolamba Pallavas, Cholas, Hoysalas, which is marked by many tank bands and temples. So they have left their mark on this city, and also the Vijayanagara temples. Then you find that Bengaluru was founded in 1537. Then you had the Marathas in 1638 to 1684 because it was so prosperous. Then you had Ranadullah Khan and Shaji. After that, his death, it went to his son Ekoji, and he signed a treaty with the Mughals, and they say that he got it, which later on was sold to Chikkadeva Raja, and it went to the Odiars. Then you find that it was 1761 to 1799 was the rule of the father and son Haider Ali and Tipu Sultan, and it was in 1809 that cantonment came into existence. Then we had the rule of the commissioners in 1831 to 1881. The Britishers made a path, they told that the king was not capable of running the state because there were some Nagara incidents. There were some skirmishes, they were very worried, they thought where they will turn against them. So they just said that you are not capable of ruling this place, and took away the rule of even the Pete, the Mysore rule. Then it was after rendition in 1881 that it was given back to the Mysore, because there was one gentleman by name Venkata Rao. So he was a brilliant administrator. So he said that when there are people like this, it was Mark Cubbon who said that when there are people like this who can take much better care of their place, why should we still oversee this? So it was in 1881 that it was given to the Odiars. And the most important names that come to mind for the work that they have done is Chamarajendra Odiar and Krishnaraja Odiar, very lovingly called as Nalwadi. And they administered the matters through their Diwans. So these Diwans were brilliant administrators and knowledgeable people who had the good of the development of the place in heart. So much so that in 1918 to 1919, this Mysore was declared as the best province amongst the British dominions. And in 1949, it was two components. There are two components, that is the Pete and the cantonment. So they got merged because there were two different distinctions. They had nothing to do with each other. You rule your area, I rule my area, was that how the matters took place. And then in 1949, it was taken under the Bangalore City Corporation, and in 2006 by BBMP. So we find that there are the, I'm just giving this in brief to understand the overall history of the cantonment, because without understanding this, if we talk something, it will not correlate. So there were British commissioners, there were John Briggs, Colonel William Morrison, C.M. Lushington, Sir Mark Cubbon, Louis Bentham Bowring, Sir Richard Mead, C.B. Saunders. And the best of these was Sir Mark Cubbon and Bowring. So whatever developments we see around us in the cantonment area is thanks to these people. And you have the roads and institutions named after them. So he was a bachelor. So when he was going back, he died on the way. He is from the Isle of Man. On the 150th year of they celebrated this man's birthday in his place, and they named a street as Bangalore Street. Then we had Mysore kings, and then they were at the matters were administered by Diwans, and they are Sri Rangacharyulu, the first Diwan, after the formation of two distinct entities. Then you had Sheshadri Iyer, Sir P.N. Krishnamurti, V.P. Madhav Rao, T. Anand Rao, Sir M.V. Visveshwaraya, Sardar Kantaraja Ars, Sir Albion Banerjee, Sir Mirza Ghalib, N. Madhav Rao, Arcot Ramaswamy Mudaliar. So of these, the most important was Sir M. Visveshwaraya. Then you had Sheshadri Iyer, and then you also had Mirza Ghalib. So most of the development, scientific, the temperament of this place and the science and technology. Today, if we are called as an IT city, it antecedents go back to the 19th century when English medium schools was introduced, and we had the first technical college, UVC, by M. Visveshwaraya in the country itself. So there were so many such things that all culminated in having a strong, intelligent workforce who could do the IT work. Then this place, little lesser known facts are that this is the place of the Mysore Lancers. The Mysore Lancers were the personal bodyguards of the Maharaja, and they were stationed in Bengaluru. So they always had transport corps, which was of the buffaloes, the oxen, and the horses. These Mysore Lancers were sent to Mesopotamia and to the Suez Canal wars, like Aleppo and places, to fight and assist the Britishers. And it was in 1917, just before the closing of the World War I, that they were sent to a place called Haifa, which is the third biggest city and the major port of Israel. So this was under the Ottoman rule, and when they saw the way it was, this thing, there was the Mount Carmel, and then there was the river. So looking at that, the British officer said, no, let's go back. But these Mysore Lancers, the soldiers, they said, we cannot afford to go back, because if we go back, we will be ostracized. It is better we die in war. So saying that, they made a decision under Colonel Desraj Ars and also Colonel Chamraj Ars, who were also responsible for the other wars. So they made a dash, and their bravery is seen in their fall of the city. The Ottoman rulers were aided by the German machinery, the state-of-art armaments. But in spite of that, it was the bravery of the Mysore Lancers that the Haifa city was liberated. And that was the end of the Ottoman rule. And even to this day, you find in Haifa that they, on September 23rd of every year, they pay respects and thank the Indian soldiers for saving them. And even this finds a mention in the textbooks of the primary schools. And in memory of this, there is a memorial just opposite the Doordarshan in RTA Nagar, and this was in memory of these brave soldiers. So that is sadly forgotten, that we had a defining role to play. Then you had this place is also known. You think that freedom fighting has taken place only in Belgaum and other areas, Dharwad and this thing. But here also freedom fighters, there are 15 to 12 places where freedom fighters, they congregated. They also had dharnas. And you have the central jail. Today it has been modified. And then it was not meant for thugs. I think it was the first jail built by the British anywhere in India. And this was to put the political prisoners. So they found that their jails were getting full, and where do we put these political prisoners? Because they had no other other than disobeying and conniving to overthrow. They were not thieves or thugs or whatever. So they sent them to the central jail, and we have people like even today they have fortunately kept remnants of how it was in the 19th century, and this was and this became the precursor for the cellular jail in the Andamans. So here you find it's very beautiful. Please, if you come, have a look here. Please go and have a look at this Freedom Park. And you find that they have maintained the gallows are there, and the sleeping areas, and also the places where the very strong political prisoners were lodged. You just go there within two minutes, we will simply have to rush out because it is so dingy, so small, so close, and no air. So, and we have the likes of people like Vajpayee, Doraiswamy Iyengar, Advani, who were all placed here. They were here during also during the emergency, later days in the emergency, they were people were here. And also what is interesting to note, besides Rabindranath Tagore and other people, we also find Gandhi visited Bengaluru 5 times. It was in 1927 that he had a major blood pressure problems, that his BP has risen so much that he had to be forcibly taken from his place, and then they suggested Bengaluru. So when he came to Bengaluru, he recuperating in Nandi Hills. So there is one of the 5 buildings which was called as the Oaks Building, which is now called as the Gandhi Building, wherein he recuperated for 4 months. And then you also find that he came along with Sardar Vallabhai Patel. When he also fell sick, he accompanied him, and he was for a few weeks here. And then we find that he could not, he was a restless soul. So he made lots of, talks, speeches. And there is NDRI in Koramangala. It is a National Dairy Research Institute. And there is a very beautiful picture of a cow, which is called as Jill. And then he very much liked it. And then there is a picture of Mahatma Gandhi with his Jill. Some very interesting episodes. Then you find that if we come to the developments in the 20th century, we see that it was Sir M. Visveshwaraya who gave thrust to the industries and the concentration for science and technology. Then you find that Central College was given to Bangalore for science, and then the Maharaja's College there at Mysore for literary activities. We had an educated workforce and electricity and manufacturing of SSI. Just 1 minute, I think I have just a minute. Yeah. And we find that it was the Diwans, like I told you, the main three Diwans, who gave a thrust to industries in Bengaluru. So MB was responsible for modernizing the silk industry and a prominent place for technology and higher education by having the first engineering college in India, which is the UVCE. And also he made the Jayanagar extension and the Sahitya Parishad. Now, Sir Mirza, was responsible for the beautification of the city by way of especially gardens and fountains. The first fountain is seen in the Kabban Park area in front of this Chamaraja Odiar's statue, marble statue made by Matre of Mumbai. So there you find was the first fountain. And there's a small plaque which many of us don't see. So it says that this was made possible by the gift by a Nepali Rani. So in those days, royalty and all, they used to rub shoulders with the Diwans. So this lady knew Mirza Ismail, and then she was here for some time. At some point of time, she had to go back. So she had two pet parrots. So she told Mirza, "I will give you this. Please take care of my two parrots because I cannot take them to Nepal. And I will give you," and she gave them 5,000 rupees for their upkeep. But Mirza Ismail thought, "Why should I need to spend? I will take care of them." And instead, in her memory, he built this first musical fountain. And he was short of that money, which he asked her, and she gave. And today, if you go in front of the statue, you find that beautiful fountain, but it is defunct. Then he also was responsible for bringing up the town hall, and he monitored the progress of the private and public sectors. Then Seshadri Iyer, he is the maker of modern Bangalore, and he had the extension of the railway lines, the KGF, and the waterworks near Hesargatta and the Shivanasamudram power station. So land was provided outside then Bangalore city as well as financial support to bring the Indian Institute of Science. Though elitist, it was set with the investments in wanting to educate the local students. And hence there was a concentration on science, and that's how we got the Central College and the Maharaja's College in Mysore for literary subjects. So it was Indian Institute of Science and Central College that helped develop a technological base in the early decades of the 20th century. So educated workforce and cheap electricity gave rise to industrialization, and we had such manufacturing units like a BHEL, BEL, HMT, HAL, ITI, etc. And townships were built in the periphery of the city. These were not in the center of the city. Don't tell you. But periphery of the city. After some times, you find that the public sector units found it, like I told, found it very effective to outsource the manufacture of components to the small scale industries. Then HAL had to overcome the imagination that a poor, illiterate country had no business aspiring to produce products that required the latest technologies. The boom in the 70s attracted a large unorganized labor force and grew rapidly till about 1981. Then we find that the changes necessitated had an impact on space. Then there was the KIADB. Was in Pina, it was acquired, and it was handed over to private industries. Then BDA was set up to acquire land, and it also developed housing. So we also find that it was this less organized workforce that was the first garment exports, and it is much substantial, like I told, than the IT boom in later on. And we also find that in 1930, what I want to tell is C.V. Raman, the Nobel Prize winner for physics, he moved to the Indian Institute of Science, and he set up the Indian Academy of Sciences also for research. It was the effective administration between the Diwans like M.V., Seshadri Iyer and Mirza, which saw a very progressive Bengaluru. Then coming to the British rule, there were several officers for whom Bengaluru became a stepping stone to their careers. So you find that Arthur Wellesley, who was the governor of Mysore, became the Duke of Wellington, defeating Napoleon at Waterloo. And Max Wilkes, who was the resident of Mysore, he became the governor of St. Helena. So this is what I wanted to show. This is in the fourth line, you will see that it is Bengaluru written in Hale Kannada, and it also mentions of the Bengaluru Kalaga, the war that took place of between a Ganga general and some say it is Nolamba. The war took place, and it was the Iraya Arasu who made this very beautiful hero stone, a pictorial hero stone, which is about 8 feet by 6 feet, which is now placed in the government museum. As you enter the government museum to the left hand side, this beautiful stone is there. It just says that this is the battle between Nagattara, and wherein his son Buttanna Setty and adopted son Peruvanna Setty died. It also mentions that 10 villages were donated to the succeeding chieftain after Nagattara's death. So you see a beautiful representation of Nagattara on horse, then the rival king. You find the soldiers aggressively fighting here, and then you'll find that there are some soldiers who have dead, and there are the animals like vultures and other animals coming here to eat the corpses, and these are the microliths. Then this is the peculiarity of Bengaluru. In one part is that there is this granite. This granite is called as Peninsular Gneiss, which is supposed to be 3,000 million years ago. So that is the another aspect, lesser known aspect of Bengaluru. And this is how Kempe Gowda is depicted, though this doesn't sound true. Of those times, he would never depict like that. But I think whoever wanted to showcase the authorities, they wanted to show him as a valorous king. And they thought that this image will serve better. So this is the map of which was drawn by Robert Holm in 1791. Whatever we have evidences or records is by the Britishers. They had a wonderful way of documenting. They documented whatever was available, the customs, this thing, including the Bengaluru, the Pete and Kote would have been. So this in the 16th century, the residence, the citizens would be here, and this is the Kote. This is the inner fourth wall, and this is the outer fourth wall, and you find that there are nine gates. So this is the Yelahanka gate, and this is the I think Anekal gate. So it is north to south and east to west, and in between you find so many lanes, which is as per the vocation or the commodities that they were selling. So this is later on done in 1600s by, they say it is by Chikkadeva Raja, and then it was reinforced by Purnaya during Tipu's time. So this is the actual Kote, this is the Pete, and this is the Kote, and it was connected. So you find that here was the Dharmambudhi Kere, which is the today's bus stand, and they had the Annamma temple. This Annamma temple is still in people's memories and people images. So you find that this was the moat where water was there. So this, the excess water would come like this, go around this, and then join the Karanji Lake. So it was a beautiful system of interconnected lakes, which when excess would be let out into the paddy and ragi fields. So this is a part of the fort, which is left, only this part is left over. And you find that there was a moat, and this moat is up to today's Victoria Hospital. Then you find that today the remnant is only this part, which is the Delhi gate. And this is the south facing one. And next here is the Victoria Hospital. So this is a very beautiful and very strong fort. And if you go on top, because now it is, there are stairs and it has been cordoned off by the ASI. But if you go there, you will get an idea of how the dungeons was. And the Britishers demolished the entire fort so that they do not become strong and become a threat to the British. So they demolished and only kept this small area. Why? Because it was Colonel Baird. he was imprisoned there for a long time, and he was responsible for leading the army in the 1799 fourth Anglo-Mysore war that killed Tipu Sultan. So it is maybe they wanted it to be a reminder of their great colonel David Baird. There is also the Baird's dungeon. That's why this part is kept intact. It had about 7 doors and 4 to 5 courtyards. Big enough to allow elephants, and it had a door that had spikes. So this was a very strong fort. Then this is the Petay area. This was all drawn in the 18th century by 19th century by the British. It is their pictures that we have. So this was how it was, as a typical shop. This is where the tradesman would do his business. Sometimes he would take rest and his family would be here. And even then, as of now, you had lots of monkeys. So this was how the row of the Avenue Road was. And it was called as Doddupete. And Doddupete and Chikkapete, which was intersected at a place wherein there is a Raja Market today. Then you find that this is called as Avenue Road because of this avenue of coconut trees. They named it so. And today, this is how the Petay is. It is all mishmash, people going, no particular thing. There is no... however they want there, but still you can find that beneath all this confusion, there is still the memory and imagination of a time of Kempe Godda's time. So this is the Kempe Godda Towers, which is ascribed to Kempe Godda I. No, it is to his successor, Kempe Godda II, who formed these towers. So they say it is 4, but then there are more than 4. And no ruler will restrict his boundary by having these boundary markers. So they served a better purpose, more like watchtowers. So they were placed at elevated places so that they could see any advancing army. They could also see if any bonfires were being made. And usually these towers were near a water body and a main road. So this is on Lal Bagh, which was not like this. It is being renovated. And you find this is the peninsular Nice. And this is near Hanumantanagar, and this is in Kempambudi Kere. So this is the Kempambudi Kere, which was 35 acres, but today it's only a small area. And the beautiful part is these two sluice gates called as Thubu. They were so beautiful that they are so decorated and very wonderful to see this beautiful, just like they look like temple towers. So this whole thing was all part of this. Today it has been gone, and there are two different levels. So the excess would be thrown down, and if it became more, it would be operated and passed on to the ragi fields nearby. But today, this is very badly maintained, and people don't know. They pass through that, but they don't know that this served a purpose. You find sluice gates in many of the water bodies in Bengaluru. Some of them have, most of them have gone, only some here or there, 3 or 4 lakes have this tube. Then this is the map for you to have an idea. This was the Petay area. This was a fort, and this is the Karanji Lake, Dharmambudi tank, which is today's bus stand. And separating the Petay and the cantonment is the Kabban Park. So the Petay people didn't want anything to do with the Britishers. They thought them as debauched people who will only drink and dance and go about in horse carriages with their girlfriends. And the British people mistrusted the Petay because they thought they are dark and they are thieves. So it worked out very well for both the Petay and the cantonment to be separate. So if by any chance the Petay had to go, or the cantonment wanted some works to be done, there was a toll gate, which is near today's town hall. So that was the the place wherein the people from one end to the other end would go, either to do some services or for some repair work or so and so. So this is the cantonment was built near the Alsur area, and you find the Alsur tank here. Then I'm not going into detail of the various types of the British architecture, the Greco-Roman or the Neo-Victorian or the Indian part of this. Just a broad idea to give that this is the typical British architecture. And you find that this is the KR Market. the Krishna Rajendra Market, which was earlier known as the New Market. So this was how it was in the 1800s. And this is the place where the electricity was switched on. And you find that the typical, there were about 800 electric bulbs on many lamps, because each lamp had four bulbs. So they were switched on 1905 in a very big gathering. And it was only later on that the cantonment had electricity. So it first was in the Pete area, because there were some problems in drawing the lines and all that. So it went at a later date. So what was like this in the 1800s, this became in 1921 as the present KR market. And we find that the new one was built by contractor and engineer Lakshmi Narsappa in 1921. He modeled this on the market of Calcutta's Hog Market. It is also called as New Market, and it was in 1997 that it has been expanded. And behind you see the, and this is the place where the flower market takes place, supposed to be one of the best in Asia. And if you go on Saturday early mornings or Sunday early mornings, you will find all the expatriates watching this phenomena of how trade takes place, the bargaining, the riot of colors. Even to this day, you find that this takes place. This auctioning early in the morning is very cheap. All the flowers from across Bengaluru and nearby come over here for their sale and for. So this is the Victoria Hospital, which is very near the KR market. So this was built when there was no big hospital in the Pete area, when the plague and cholera and other diseases took place. So it was inaugurated in 1887, which was a jubilee year, 60th jubilee year of Queen Victoria. So it was dedicated to her by Vani Vilasa Sannidhini. See, both our, not only the Maharajas, but even the queens had a role in the development of Bangalore with facilities, with many facilities. So she was the one, she could have had this hospital built in her name, but she dedicated it to Queen Victoria's reign. And you find that there is so much of similarity in these roofs, the mansard roofs. And you find that they are gabled, and then you find this typical pillars of the Roma Greco style. And this is how it is today. And most parts of it, there were some extra buildings, they have all been demolished. So in 1900, it became operational. And also the first telephone was operated in this place. Why? Because the doctors had to be on call in case there was an emergency. So this is, there are three hospitals now in Pete area, the Minto Hospital, the Victoria Hospital, and you also find Vani Vilasa Hospital, and a little way other you have the St. Martha's Hospital. Then this is the Indian structure. This is the Fort High School, which is a little bit further south from the Pete. And this was a school which was somewhere in 1800s. You still find the, this is the Mangalore tiles. And then you find the British structure in these poles and this, semicircular windows. And today it was first opened as a school for English medium school for boys. Then it was shifted during the plague to the Tipu's palace. And later on, it was only in 1913 that this school is now functioning. This is the place where the very famous the Ram Navami celebrations and the Fort High School, the Gana Sabha, takes place here for about 1 month. We had Kengal Hanumantaya, who were the students in this place, besides other well-known dignitaries. And Kengal Hanumantaya was so, his alma mater, he had such a fascination that even though he was the chief minister, he would come here with only one constable and teach. Even after his retirement, as he was staying in Chamrajpet area, even after his retirement as chief minister, he would come here and teach. So this is a very famous armory of Tipu Sultan, which is very neglected. So this played a major role in the two bloodiest wars. So this building is just behind the Bangalore Medical College and Research Center now. So this is a place where arms, armaments, rockets were stored. And it was in a depression so that nobody could, the enemies could not attack. And even if attacked, it wouldn't, the damage would be very less. And this, it is vaulted so that should it, anything happen to this, it will just fall inside and it will not be a threat. So beautifully done. It is nearly about 16 to 17 feet in height. Very and it is also airy. It is, he has built it in such a material that it gives a little bit of coolness, maybe because of the nature of the produce, ammunition being stored there. Maybe this sort of a thing was very beautiful. Today it is not taken by ASI or the state archaeology with BBMP. And when I take my students there, the caretaker also Iliyake. So that is the feeling of most of the people. So there should be something to say that, look, this played a very decisive role. So why not we maintain it? There is no even a name plaque. And this is the Tipu's palace. A part of it is left over. It's a huge, big place where the medical college was there. It was a parade grounds. It had east wing and west wing. This is a, only a part of the west wing is left here. These are the wooden fluted pillars brought from Shimoga and the typical Muslim architecture of these arches. It is very cool. He had, from this place, he had, balconies from where he would come and address the people. There were both sides up and back. Then in the Pete area, you find found the Minto Hospital. So this eye hospital was formed in 1913, which looks like this. Very strange. It does not look like a hospital building at all, but it is a stone building named after Minto, who was a viceroy and a governor general in the Mysore period, named after him. And they give, it is about 300 bedded hospital, and they give free treatment for all types of eye hospital. Then this is the Vani Vilasa Hospital, which was named in 1930 by Nalwadi, her son, in the name of his mother. It has got typical European as well as indigenous architecture, very beautifully done. Today it is an exclusive hospital for women, and even a pediatric ward is added to this. So these are the buildings in the Kampan Park. You find that this is the Government Museum, which was in 1865 in the museum, in today's post office, which is on Museum Road, which was the jail. Then for after that, it was shifted to another building. And in memory of that, that road is still named as Museum Road. And it was one Edward Buffer. He was a surgeon who came from, who was 10 years administering the Madras Museum. He came here and took charge of this. And later on, this is the part. This is an extension, the wing which was extension. And the entry today, it is like this. But earlier, it was facing the Visveshwaraya Museum. So it's a very beautiful museum, one of the second oldest in South India. And you find that there are two floors and a very beautiful collection of artifacts. You have even the Halmidi inscription, wherein there is the first reference in 458 AD about the mention of Kannada as a language. And this is the K. Sheshadri Iyer Memorial Library. It looks like two different buildings. This is the front part and this is the back part. So here you find it is in a typical neo-Gothic style with the pediments and the pillars, and this is in apsidal. So it is very beautiful with about 9 lakh books, and it has got about 1 lakh books for the children. Then this is the famous High Court, which was earlier known as Atara Kachari, because after the British shifted from Srirangapatna to here, they shifted the whatever records to Tipu's palace. Then as the business grew that could not accommodate, they brought it here, which was built in 1866 or 68. And then it was known as Atara Kachari. Then after the Vidhan Sauda was built in just in front of it, this became the High Court, because the High Court was one of the 18 departments which was functioning. It's a very beautiful building with about nearly 2 lakh area square meter space, very airy, and it has got verandas throughout, running throughout its structure. So the entry to this building was from the other side. It had a row of steps, which Hanumanthaiah saw that, and he wanted this building to be demolished. But he said, okay, no, I will build up the Vidhan Sautha and on a much more grander scale. So that's why the steps are very high, and it is really one of the best assembly legislators in Bengaluru. And we should also know that Bengaluru is known for statues. This is the Chamarajendra Vadiyar statue, and this is the statue of Mark Kabban, which had a very grand opening. Even before the High Court was made, it in the Kabban Park, it was called as the Mead Park, named after one of the commissioners. So this was a very grand opening. You find all the British officers and soldiers were here for the gathering. And today it has been shifted to the backside, saying that why do we need a person of the caliber of Mark Kabban, not related to law at all. So he was shifted, and after that there was some galata both by Vattal Nagaraj and also by the lawyers. As such, this has now been shifted from the High Court premises, and it is kept near the bandstand. So if you go now there, this place is now kept over there. This is a statue which was imported from Italy. It was Marochetti, an Italian sculptor, who made this beautiful statue on a horse. And he made it in such a way that when the sun reflects on the right side of his face, it looks very majestic. So, and indeed, the work that he has done for Bangalore is immeasurable. So this is the Vidhan Sautha and the Bangalore Palace. And what is to be remembered is we have two Nada Habbas. The one is the Kadlakai Parishe and the other is the Karaga. So the Kadlakai Parishe takes place in the Baswanagudi temple. This is the present temple, how it looks. And this was how it was some years back. Even till 19, this is the backside of the temple. There was this kere. And also people used to come up till 1960s. They used to come and dip their, immerse their Ganeshas. And it is in the left leg of this Basava that there is an inscription which says that this is the birthplace of the river Vrishabhavati. If only our policy makers had maintained this river, this would be like the River Thames of London. But today it is the stink river. As soon as you come from Mysore near Kengeri, your nostrils are assailed with an with a smell that because of all the effluents, the waste from the industries and sanitary, this thing is poured there, that it has leads to such a situation. And then this is Kadlakai Parishe, which happens once in a year on the Kartik Masa, November, the last Purnami day. But then there is also another historicity, though this is a legend, which says that there was a bull that was coming and destroying the crops in, because this there are all some 8 to 9 villages. Sunkinahalli was one of the villages where they say groundnut was grown. But if you see the records of the British, especially Francis Buchanan, you find that there is no mention of groundnuts in his book, which is My Journey from Madras to the Countries of Mysore, Coorg and Malabar. So he has documented all the available crops growing in that area, and it was published in 1807, and there was no mention of this. It is only the British. So possibly it was only the British who grew these crops there, because they knew that the French were making use of the groundnut oil for their soaps. So they sensed an opportunity to make a commerce. So they grew that, and the oils was exported to France to make their oil. In fact, it became so popular and it was much cheaper that the olive oil there was mixed with the groundnut oil which was sent from India. So probably we also have to understand the legend as well as the historicity for a better understanding of the happenings in the city. So this is the Karaga, and it is done by the people who are into the horticulture. So these were the people who were called as the Darogas. These Darogas were the official gardeners of Lal Bagh, brought in by Tipu Sultan when he went on his trip, Arcot and all those places. He saw that the gardens were very beautifully maintained. So he brought them, and the Darogas were, who are the Muslims. So they were in charge of taking care of these Tiglas. So the Tiglas called themselves as coming from us, Vahini Kulas Kshatriyas, because they say that we have come from the hair of Draupadi. So actually it is a cult of Amman, Mariamman in fact, from Tamil Nadu, who used to take care of the health and the wealth of these people, because they needed water. So they would see that they would pray to her for adequate rain and for good health, so that they are not attacked by any diseases. But then with the integration with the mainstream Sanskritization, they also take their origins to Mahabharata and to Draupadi. So this is the place where in the Sankey lake, there is one lake, not Sankey lake, it is Sampangi Kere. So Sampangi Kere, there's a small part which is left. It is now today's cricket stadium. So a part of that is left so that they will have a link to their past. So that is how they, in a secret, she is born in a Kalasa. And here you find that he is a man who takes the form of a woman. And you find that there is the concept of the divine in the secular, and you find that the whole thing becomes like an urban carnival and a sacred city. This thing is attributed to this. So he becomes a woman, he takes the Mangal Sutra of his wife, he wears bangles, abstains from everything, and then he carries a kalasha which has got flowers draped in it like a shikara. So he goes around the temple, around the Pete area, and the Annamma temple is one port of call, as well as Tawakkal Mastan Dargah. So it's a beautiful integration of communal harmony. It is said that the Sufi saint who used to regularly come to this Dharmaraya temple, he fainted one day. He was administered a treatment by these people, and in gratitude he said, "I will be very happy if the Karaga comes to my Dargah." So it goes, it pays there. Without going to the Annamma temple and to the Dargah, the circle of the Karaga is not coming. So we find that this Devi, in incarnation of Devi, is surrounded by this Veera Kumaras. So in case this arrangement falls to the ground, then he is killed by these Veera Kumaras. So this is a very interesting happening, which is even seen to this day. Nidhi, can I continue or do I close?
Ma'am, please continue.
Thank you so much. And now we come to the last part, another 10 minutes, and then we are over, because I have spoken about the unknown in the known, some narratives, some facts, and now we come to the imaginations and their times, how imaginations also have a bearing on a city. So you find that history of Bangalore is marked by the emergence of dominant groups, each having their own set of imaginations. The dramatic way the city was imagined when it became Bangalore from Bengaluru in 1799, it should be remembered that Bengaluru was a military center in the second half of 18th century, with the two wars taking place there, which had advanced arms, ammunition, and especially the metal encased rocket, the first of its kind in the world itself, and many foundries and armory. From the cantonment in the early 19th century to the then public sectors in the middle 20th century, and to the IT industry in the 21st century, all these emerging growth centers were on the boundaries of the city. They were not a part of the city per se. They were not in the center of the city. They were on the boundary. So this also had an impact on the Bangaloreans and their imaginations of the city. Similarly, with the rise of the public sector, cantonment disappeared from the Bengaluru image when once the manufacturing units came into being. So by the rise of IT, the city ignored the public sector and defense moorings. Though the Indian Air Force runs the country's most prominent air show in Bangalore, The cities, you have about 600 aircraft from all across the world coming here to showcase the latest in the aircraft technology. Then the city's educated engineering manpower was the strongest magnet in attracting investment for the IT. So this manpower in turn owed a great deal to the highly subsidized system of higher education of the 18th, 19th century. So it is very interesting that even there is an imagination for animals also. The worship of Hanuman, you find that there are many Hanuman temples. All these are on the boundaries of the villages. So the worship of Hanuman provided a great deal of latitude for the monkeys. The dens, we also saw a slide wherein I showed you there were monkeys going on in the Pete area. So we find that there was the south side was full of dense forest and groves, and they had lots of monkeys. And also there were snakes also in the nearby vicinity. That's why we have an area which is called as Nagarabadi. So that was a place where there were so many snakes. And the animals also were major means of transport. There is one type of breed called as Amruta Mahal. So there was one also type of oxen which Tipu used to carry the cannons from his place of manufacture, which was in the Pete, to the, say, the Kote underneath. They were so fast that the Britishers were confused and surprised. How is he able to bring so many cannons one after the other? That was because underground he had a tunnel wherein the oxen, they were very fast, a special breed of oxen who used to carry these cannon balls to the place wherein they would put it for shoot it at the Britishers at the other end. Then you also had the, like I told, the Mysore Lancers. They fought the war with only horses and lances. There is no other equipment, and some had some swords. Other than this, there was no machinery, no gunpowder, nothing of the sort. In spite of that, their bravery was so much that they won the war with the lances and horses. So, but then this is forgotten and no longer the imagination when the British dominated after 1799. If at all the interpretation of the past from the present is seen, is how B.L. Rice, who was the one who documented and wrote gazetteers, insisted that the towers were boundary markers. Like I showed you, he was the one who insisted that I understand this, so these are only boundary markers. Though he never thought that a founder will never restrict the boundary, he would like to expand. And this has still remained in the imagination of the people, that they are boundary markers rather than being the watchtowers. So ironically, the disregard for the past also distorts the perception of the present. The 1799 war was the most important change in the imagination of the city. From a prominent textile and military center, and also the ally of the French, because Tipu also had an ally with the French, Napoleon Bonaparte. It was reduced to a city that only British thought that they could rule for. They had nothing to do with the Pete. The Britishers did not like the silk and the colors that were produced in the Pete area. And the military power was shifted to the cantonment, and Pete did not gain its military stature at all. That's why you find that Cavalry Road, South Parade Road, Infantry Road, the barracks, you find all these roads named because they made it like it's a cantonment wherein there is a space for their military structure. Then you find that the Anglo-Indian community became prominent in the cantonment, and it saw their migration after independence. Though they left a legacy in education, that became an important factor later for the IT industry. Yet another imagination was born. Then they saw themselves as an elite among non-British residents, and they wanted an area for themselves which is called as Whitefield. Then the plague of the 19th century created new localities that were open and less prone to filth and congestion, because the Pete area, they had frequently cholera, then plagues because of the insanitary condition. That's why when they built Chamrajpet and Basmanagudi, the conservancy lanes was built behind the houses. The built environment of a city constitutes the imagination of the city that also determines its sustainability. So the Attara Kacheri reflects the preference of the old Mysore imagination, and Vidhan Sauda reflects the opulence in another imagination. So also many ordinary buildings, they also reflect many imaginations. So the cantonment had a prominent place for engineers, because it was designed by Lieutenant Colonel John Blackstone, a young 21-year-old who thought that this will be over in 3 years, but he finished it in 1 year. So it is the home of the indigenously developed light combat aircraft. Then you see, that's why the air show takes place every year in the month of February. And thus we see that these imaginations have a different bearing on different types of people. So in the end, I would like to conclude and say that more than a feeling of nostalgia while celebrating the old, we should rejoice in the present, as there is still enough left of historical Bengaluru when one goes on a heritage walk. Because people now say, enide ella biddhogide and all. Even if ene biddhogidru, no, there are so many things. If you just take a walk, you will find that there is a past even in the present. We can understand. And if you read a little bit, you can make two and two and reconstruct the history of the cultural history, the history of this city. In fact, there is a scope for making 76 heritage walks. And if there was a possibility to make it like an open heritage history book like London, there are scope for making 5,000 plaques. But there is so much has changed, but so much is still left to observe and learn. But for the students of architecture and urban planning, they can learn from the present Bengaluru what not to do. Either way, the city is very interesting. So these are the heritage walks that I have conducted for the students. And it is very interesting when I interact with these students and they get so overwhelmed that they feel that, yes, wherever we are staying, we will go and look into the history of the place. So the city belongs to us. So we should be very much interested in knowing its background, its cultural heritage, so that it gives us an identity. So we are who we are by the city that makes it, because a city is also the people who make it, and the people are also what the city makes it. So thank you so much, Manali and Nidhi. I have overshot. This is how sometimes I get so carried away. So I also thank the audience for patiently bearing with me and listening, and I hope that you did get some takeaways from this talk.
Definitely, ma'am. We have no problem with the time. Actually, we would have loved if you would have still continued, because it was really very interesting. And yes, still today we had looked at Bengaluru as only an IT city or a capital city of Karnataka. But today we have learned so many things, some known, some unknown that we had missed. And it was really a very informative and interesting lecture, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am.
So, open to questions.
Yes, ma'am. There are questions here in the comment section.
I hope I answered it satisfactorily.
Yes, ma'am. The question from Shri Nandan Shastri, sir, from Gujarat. Is there any attempt to apply to UNESCO to propose Bengaluru as World Heritage City? And he has one more question. Is there a website for imparting information for heritage walks within the city?
In fact, Destination Heritage conducts these walks. And if you want to know about these walks, there is a book by Intac written by Dr. Meera Iyer, which is called Discovering Bangalore. She has written about some walks and the places you come across. And answering the first question, we are a long, long way to declare Bengaluru as a heritage city, not like how Gujarat has been, Ahmedabad has been branded. That is because, like I told you, there is no maintenance and there is no ownership, and people don't understand. If even the there are so many houses where C.V. Raman, the bigwigs stayed there, but we don't even have plaques like how we have markers, blue markers, which say that this is where so-and-so lived. We don't even have such a facility. We don't even have plaques, and we don't have good system. And where do you think? And there is no ownership either with the local people or with the policy makers. And where do you think? We are a long, long way off, Nandanji, for making this city a heritage city. It is very difficult, because we in the mad rush for increasing our coffers, the mafia is simply grabbing land left, right, and center, and whatever is in its path is demolished. Before we know what has happened, they have demolished, taken away so many trees. Are the trees not heritage trees? Could you not build across it? In other cities like Japan and all that, they build around the trees. We can do it, but we take the easy way out. Everything destruction. So where is the scope for this to become a heritage city like Ahmedabad, Mr. Nanjandi? It is very sad, though. It is people like us who are really worked upon this, but there's nothing that we can do. It's only the powers to be who has to have an interest that heritage matters.
Thank you, ma'am. There are questions from Dr. T.S. Ravishankar, sir. How many heritage buildings in Bangalore are under the control of Directorate of Archaeology of Karnataka? And he has another question. Are there any attempts to conserve and preserve them? And the last part of his question, what is the role of Intact in preservation?
Okay, I'll take from this. In the role of Intact is, like I said, they made a list of what are all the heritage buildings. So they know at least some, because documentation is very important. So they made a document of this many buildings, 834 buildings were there. Today we find that 354. And whatever little they have done, they have preserved. For example, you take the Mohan building in Chikpet. It's a very beautiful building with about 120 years story, and they have preserved it. And there's another building number 37, and they have also taken some other buildings. They are doing it, but they can do only this much, because each project takes so much of, I think their funding also is very difficult. So if the government passes a rule and a heritage body is there to actively put this into across, then I think the buildings can be preserved. I think totally around 600 in Karnataka, 600 buildings are under monuments are under ASI, and here there are hardly a handful, not many of them, and they are interested otherwise in other things, saying that because the funding has been stopped, there earlier there was about 25 lakhs to do some renovation work and all that, but today it is only about 5 lakhs that is given. So what can they do with that money? So that is hardly adequate. So I think it is the powers to be that should give importance for heritage. So I think then maybe that even if state archaeology is included in heritage, not made a separate this thing, where they will get the resources to, keep up the buildings, make some renovations, take care of them. So it is of this that because of lack of funds that we are not able to maintain the, keep them in good working condition. Have I answered all the three questions that Dr. Ravishankar has asked?
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. You have answered all of them. There are no more questions in the comment section. Nidhi, do you have anything to add?
No, not at all. But ma'am, it was really a very, very interesting lecture. Many things which we didn't know, you have enlightened us about those topics concerned with Bangalore city. Thank you so much, ma'am. Literally, it was very enlightening lecture.
Thank you so much. It has been my pleasure also. So I am very passionate about this city, and I conduct, if those who are interested can contact me, we conduct, I don't know about how the condition is now, but I used to conduct heritage walks, mainly focusing on the students, because it is they, if they are given a proper informed awareness of the city's information and heritage, maybe they will, when they go back to their places, because most of these students are from outside Karnataka. So at least they will know, yes, let's take care and let's have an identity. Maybe this, if it creates an informed awareness in these students, then the purpose of this heritage walks is that's why it's served. That's why I do it only for the students. I don't do it for the general public, because they'll come, they listen, they'll enjoy and go. Because I want some takeaway from these walks, and it is only the youngsters who can, maybe if I can kindle one person in his heart, yes, I should take care of the monuments in my area, then maybe it augurs well for heritage.
Yes, ma'am, definitely. It will be, we will take this as a message for all the youngsters, and not only Bangalore city, but wherever we are, yes, in any part of Karnataka or India, we will definitely try to preserve and protect the monuments that are around us, and create an awareness among the general public also as much as we can from our side. So we will definitely work in this direction, ma'am. Thank you so much for the wonderful
message.
Thank you
so much. It has been a pleasure to coming on this platform and share my thoughts. It's very less. There is much more to that we can share. But this was a very. But anyway, you gave me some leverage of the time, and I could bring out certain things which I had in mind to the students. Thank you so much. So much.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. We have come to the end of the online lecture, and I now request Ms. Nidhi Katti to propose a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Manali. Today's lecture, it was really a very fantastic lecture, and it gave us a new outlook, particularly about Bangalore city and how to protect monuments which are around us. It also gave us an outlook to spread awareness in public, for general public, to preserve, protect our monuments. Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving such a beautiful lecture on our page. We are blessed that you accepted our invitation and gave this lecture. Thank you so much, ma'am. It's an honor to have you on board.
Thank you so much. And, you are very persistent also. Thank you.
And I also thank all the audience who had joined us throughout this lecture. And please continue your support to our The History Enthusiast page. Without your support, our page cannot be successful. Sure, is very necessary for us. Continue your support. And I also thank co-founder and co-host Ms. Manali Momaya. Without her support, nothing is like anything in this page cannot be done. She is like always supports for new ideas, encourages, and I'm glad we both are doing such great work. And I thank her also. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Nidhi. Once again, I would like to remind any research scholars who are watching us, we invite you to our page to present book reviews on any books of history, archaeology, any book related to the subject that you might have read and understood something from. You can present a book review on our page, and we will definitely post it on the in our YouTube channel. So kindly contact us. Thank you, ma'am. We are going offline now. Thank you
so much.